Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Donna Minio. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial-A-Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your question. All right, we'll go to the questions and daily challenge in a minute, but first, we would like to let you know a little later in our show, Mike Radell from Camp Eager will be here as part of our Move to Include series. Mike will be talking to us about what the camp is and why it is important.
Now, I think it's time for tonight's brain teaser.
Let's do it.
All right, born in Virginia in 1755, this judge held many roles before settling into his most important. He was born the first of 15 children to a land surveyor who was friends with George Washington. When the Revolutionary War broke out, this man joined the Virginia militia. Eventually, he was appointed chief legal officer to George Washington. He left the army in 1780 to pursue a legal career. His only legal training was a 6-week lecture course. Despite his lack of formal legal training, this man was very active in Virginia state politics.
In 1800, he was appointed Secretary of State by President John Adams. He stayed in that position for only a short time. And by 1801, he was appointed the fourth Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. During his tenure, he was known for expanding the role and power of the Supreme Court. He introduced the idea of judicial review in the landmark case Marbury versus Madison. He served as the Chief Justice for 34 years, hearing over 1,000 cases and helping to determine the role of the Supreme Court and the federal government.
If you think you can solve the brain teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
And every correct response will be added to our Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
All right. I think it is time for some homework.
All right, sounds good.
I think Sophia's out there.
Okay, Sophia, hello.
Sophia, you there?
Yeah.
Hi, Sophia.
Hi, Sophia. I'm going to go to the board so you can read me your problem, okay?
Okay.
All right. All right, honey, can you give me the problem for me?
Yes. Jack had 3 pennies, and his little sister Annie had 10 pennies. And Jack wanted 10 pennies exactly like his little sister Annie. How many more does Jack need to have the same amount as Annie?
Okay, as Annie, right? All right, so Jack, in the long run, Jack has 3 and his sister has 10. So what Jack wants to have as many as his sister. So what are you working on in math class right now? Adding, subtracting, multiplying, dividing, what are you working on?
Minusing and plus.
Okay, so we're working on adding and subtracting. So what we're gonna do, are you doing tape diagrams or are you just learning how to count it out?
We're doing a chart that has a line in the middle and says tens and ones.
Okay. All right, so if we did tens and ones on a chart, okay, how many does Jack have right now?
3.
So does that equal 10 pennies yet?
Yeah.
3 pennies is 10 pennies?
No.
We got to keep going. So what if I double what Jack has, if I add 3 more? So what is 3 plus 3?
3 plus 3 is 6.
Okay, is that up to 10 yet?
No.
No, so we can add some more there, right?
Yeah.
Okay, what do you want to add to this now? How much more do you think?
Four.
You want to add 4 more? Okay, we'll add 4 more. And what's 6 plus 4?
4. You want to add 4 more? Okay.
Yeah. So listen to me, honey. Listen to me on the phone. Dad, what's 6 plus 4?
6 plus 4 equals 10.
10. Excellent. Excellent. So now we're up to the 10, but we have to sort of figure out on what we did how many more he needed. So the way we set this up is we added 3 and then we added 4. So we end up having to do 3 plus 4 to find out how many more pennies he needs. So what's 3 plus 4?
4. 3 plus 4 is 7.
Excellent. So Jack needed how many more pennies?
7.
7 pennies. Sophia, thank you for calling us.
Okay.
Bye-bye, sweetheart.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
All right, we have our next caller, Hope, with some homework. Hope, are you out there?
Yeah.
Hi, what are we working on tonight, Hope?
I have a math problem.
I'm heading over to the board, and we're going to do some math tonight, okay?
Okay.
All right, what do you got for me, please?
I have a decimal of 0.325.
All right, 0.325. What do we have to do with that decimal now?
We have to turn that into a fraction.
All right, so when I look at this, I have 3 numbers. I have tens, hundreds, and thousands, and that's going to tell me what this number has to be over to turn it into a fraction, all right? So mm-hmm. What am I going to actually put this over to make it into a fraction? Tens, hundred, thousands.
Okay.
So we're going to have to put it over 1,000, okay? Because if we put it over tens, then we're going to have a numerator that's going to be larger than the denominator. We actually want the numerator smaller than the denominator. And when I've done this, I've actually eliminated the decimal from it. So when I write out 0.325, that as a fraction is the same as 325 over 1,000. Okay? Now, I know your teacher's going to say you can't leave it like that because there's something we can do to this fraction. What's that called?
You can simplify it.
I can simplify or I'm going to reduce it. So because both of these numbers end with a 5 or a 0, I know that I can divide both of them, both the numerator and the denominator, by 5. All right? So I'm going to bring my 325 over here. So I got some scratch paper here. So I go 325 and I divide that by 5. And I know 5 goes into 32 how many times?
That goes into...
It's going to go in 6, right? And 6 times 5 is going to give me 30. All right, when I subtract 2 from 0, I get 2, and I got to bring down my 5. And 5 goes into 25 how many times?
2 goes into, wait, what?
5 goes into 25 how many times?
5 times.
It's going to go 5 times. So my numerator now, I've reduced it to 65, and 1,000 divided by 5, let's go 1,000 inside, and 5 goes into 10, 2, and I know it's going to be 200 all the way out, okay? So 200. Now, once again, Hope, we can see that my numbers end with a 5 or a 0. That means that can also be divided by 5 again, okay? So I'm going to divide by 5, and I'm going to divide by 5 again. So 65 now divided by 5 is how much? 5 goes into 6 how many times?
5 goes into 6 one time.
1 times 5 gives me 5. I subtract, gives me a 1. I bring my 5 down, gives me 15. 5 goes into 15 how many times?
5 goes into 15.
Three times. Yep, we know three. And then 200 divided by 5, 200 divided by 5. 5 goes into 20, we know it goes 4, which is going to give me a 20 with a... All right, so now we have just reduced this to 13 over 40. Now, I know right away that the number 13 is what kind of number, Hope? Begins with a P. Can only be divided by itself and the number, or one and itself, and that's a prime number, right?
Prime number, right.
All right, so now I know that 13 over 40 doesn't matter what the denominator is or what the numerator is, because that numerator right now is a prime number. I can't go any farther. So I have reduced 0.325 into a fraction of 13 over 40, and we know we can't go any farther because 13 is a prime number. All right, Hope?
Okay.
Fantastic. You did a great job. You call back with some more of those anytime, okay?
Okay, thank you.
You're Bye. Welcome. Bye. I said,
hey, hey. Here's a fun saying to help you remember the basic needs of the human body. Oh, can Venus flies make pretty webs? This actually helps you remember oxygen, carbohydrates, vitamins, fats, minerals, protein, water.
All right, we'll go back to the questions in just a minute. This year, Homework Hotline has teamed up with the Golisano Foundation to bring you a new series called Move to Include. Throughout this series, we'll be learning about different intellectual and physical disabilities, and more importantly, we want people to be more inclusive of those with disabilities. In this week's Move to Include video, we visit Camp Eager, which is designed for children living with the disorder of epilepsy and also for their siblings. Check it out.
My name is Michael Radell. I'm the community educator and also our camp director for Epilepsy Prelude Incorporated. I run a camp for kids with epilepsy. Epilepsy is a neurological disorder that causes individuals to have the symptom of a seizure. The seizure is an abnormal electrical activity in the brain that alters one or more of the following things: their awareness, their behavior, their sensation. And so when they're in the midst of a seizure, they may or may not be aware that they're having a seizure. We're at Camp Eager today, and we are about halfway through the week, and the kids have been enjoying activities such as archery, canoeing, wall climbing. These are all activities that the kids can participate in throughout the course of the week, and they just get a chance to be together and, regardless of their seizure activity, have fun.
Oh, look at that. Beautiful bullseye.
Hi, my name is Mackenzie and I have seizures.
Hi, my name is Caitlin and I live with someone who has epilepsy and seizures.
This is a really nice camp because it's like everybody has epilepsy and everybody gets to bond, and then I meet siblings that deal with it too. And it's really a nice bonding experience, isn't it?
And we get to meet like new people every year.
Yeah, everybody's definitely really friendly.
Mm-hmm.
It's really nice because if somebody has a seizure, it's not like when you're in like a place where nobody knows about it, because you don't have to stop what you're doing. People at the health lodge will worry about those people, and everybody else can continue on with their day. She had a big one on Sunday.
I had the grand
mal seizure.
Yeah, the grand mal where you fall over. And basically, the counselors took care of me.
Most of the counselors here do have epilepsy, but then there are some sibling counselors too.
Yeah.
There's a lot of children that can go to a summer camp and have a good experience and come home and be fine. An individual who has a disorder of epilepsy, there has to be some extra precautions taken so that they can have that kind of same fun, but still stay safe in the same time. Camp Eager is special because people get to come here and the first thing they walk through the door, they have something instantly in common with everybody else here. The campers, a lot of the counselors are affected by the disorder of epilepsy. So when they say seizure, everyone understands what they're talking about. We don't have to go through and explain what a seizure is and how to care for someone who has epilepsy, because they all have that working knowledge just because of their day-to-day lives. You probably know someone who has the disorder of epilepsy, so I would take this opportunity to learn more about the disorder and understand it, so you have a better understanding of what they are going through and what they have been going through.
This video was part of Homework Hotline's move to include. We really want to know what you think about tonight's video. Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and tell us what you think by clicking on the Move to Include survey button. And while you are there, check out our other Move to Include videos.
Now we would like to welcome Mike to our Homework Hotline studio.
How are you?
And you are the director or the founder of this camp?
No, I'm not the founder. I work for Epilepsy Parade Incorporated, and I run a camp for kids with epilepsy.
Fantastic.
We've had the camp for about 23 years now.
So tell us a little bit more about what epilepsy is.
Well, epilepsy is a neurological impairment that causes individuals to have reoccurring seizures. They can look a lot different and depending on who you are. You can have a tonic-clonic seizure, which makes you have like convulsions, or you can have a absence seizure, which makes you just kind of stare off into space. It depends on where in the brain these seizures are occurring is what type of seizure you have.
So is that kind of like daydreaming?
It is, but it causes a lack of awareness. So when you daydream, you're just kind of not paying attention. But when you're having an absence seizure, you're literally not there for a period of time.
Sometimes it can come up and go like this.
Yeah, and you don't even remember that the seizure even occurred.
In the video, they mentioned a grand mal seizure. What is that?
Well, grand mal is what we used to call a tonic-clonic seizure. Grand mal doesn't tell us a lot. It means big bad. But tonic-clonic is the type of seizure that some people have. It's a generalized seizure, which means it happens throughout the whole brain. And sometimes people get very rigid, very stiff, and then they start to convulse or shake, and that's tonic-clonic.
Okay. Now, is epilepsy something you're born with, or is it something that develops over time?
Mm-hmm. Sometimes people can be born with starting to have seizures right from birth. It depends on, you know, sometimes there's complications at birth or things like that. Sometimes it's genetic. But a lot of times people acquire seizures. There's an injury to the brain, or they have some type of meningitis or something like that, that eventually they start having seizures. It could occur at any age. I know some people who have had seizures since birth, and also some people who started having seizures well into their adult life.
So the seizure really is an electrical imbalance, or it's an electrical signal that courses over the surface of the brain?
Exactly. Seizure is a neurological impairment that causes the brain cells to misfire. So if you have a seizure, your body is impaired for that period of time when you're having the seizure, but otherwise you're fine. You can, you know, go to school, you can work, you can play, you can run and jump, but when you're having the seizure, sometimes you're either your movement, your sensations, your behaviors, and sometimes your awareness is impaired.
So now with medication, what is, you can take medication, but is it like a seizure control thing, and what is like seizure control?
The first time you have a seizure, sometimes your primary care physician, your doctor, will tell you to see a neurologist. And a neurologist is a specialized type of doctor who works with the brain, and a lot of times the first line of defense for the neurologist to help control these seizures are medications. And a long time ago, there wasn't very many medications out there, but now they have several different medications for the neurologist to choose from, depending on what type of seizures you have. And hopefully, after the first line of medication, your seizures stop, and that's it forever. But a lot of times, people who have what they call infractory epilepsy, which means it continues to happen even though you're taking medication to control that.
Okay. Now, you sort of explained what happens in the brain as far as what it's doing to the body. Now, there's a lot of things we've heard in regards to the eyes rolling to the back of the head, swallow the tongue. What else does epilepsy really do to your body?
Right. Well, a lot of times it depends on the type of seizure you're having. We talked about tonic-clonic. Mm-hmm. A lot of times when someone has a tonic-clonic seizure, their awareness is impaired, and also their movements are impaired. So that during the period of time when that individual is having the seizure, they may not remember that seizure happened. They may have some convulsions. When someone says swallow their tongue or foam at the mouth or eyes rolls in the back of the head, a lot of times that's a myth or a stigma associated with people who have had these seizures. You can't swallow your tongue. It's impossible.
Right.
So a lot of times in seizure first aid, we tell people to, you know, turn the person on their side, and that will open up that airway so people can breathe. Your eyes can't roll to the back of your head and things
I'll
like
try.
That too.
can't do that.
And foam at the mouth, you know, people don't foam at the mouth. It's just a lot of times things are impaired, like I said, the jaw muscles, and they can't process that saliva, and it comes out in the form of drool.
So why is having a camp eager so important for children or people with epilepsy?
Yeah, epilepsy is not a cookie cutter disorder. So that means it looks different in everybody. But one thing that Camp Eager is so great about is because people can come to the camp and they have one thing in common. They've been diagnosed with a disorder of epilepsy, or they've been affected by the disorder of epilepsy in one way, shape, or form. So when someone says seizure at camp, everyone knows what they're talking about. It's really no big deal. We have medical personnel and the counselors, the volunteers that are there, are very well versed with epilepsy, and we can have the activities that camp offers, like swimming and canoeing and wall climbing and archery and things like that. And if someone has a seizure, we take care of that individual who's having a seizure, and the activity continues.
That's very cool.
And they receive a lot of support from each other, knowing that there's other people out there that have the disorder of epilepsy. And we try to normalize their time there as much as possible so that they can feel included and do those things that most every other child in the whole entire world is able to do during a summer camp experience.
Sure.
What kind of resources are out there to assist people with epilepsy, or just people that have people in the family with epilepsy?
Sure. We tell families a lot of times to definitely consult your neurologist if, you know, you're having seizures, and they can certainly help you with the seizure control and try to get you an effective treatment to stop those seizures. But after you come out of the doctor's office, a lot of times there's nowhere for someone to turn. I work at an agency called Epilepsy Prelude Incorporated, and it is an agency working with individuals who have neurological impairments, developmental disabilities, and traumatic brain injury as well. And it's we service 22 counties in upstate New York, and one of the programs that we have is Camp Eager. So it's an opportunity for these families and children to get some support and to be involved and to talk with other parents or talk with other adults who are going through the same kind of things and possibly receive services to help them with their disorder.
So now, being a person with a disability as yourself, how do you approach people, and how would you encourage people to approach yourself with a disability?
Right. I was diagnosed with epilepsy as a teenager. Good news, the seizures have gone away a long time ago. I think I've been seizure free for 19 years now.
Nice.
My neurologist and I were able to work and get a medication that helped me to, you know, get rid of the seizures. And so a lot of times when we work with our families and individuals, we encourage them to seek that medical care and come to our agency for some help. But if people who have epilepsy or any other disability, they're just like anybody else, you know, and just because they have seizures doesn't make them any different. Or, you know, of course, we shouldn't pick on anybody who has epilepsy or having experience in seizures. They're responsible for their homework. and they're also really great kids and adults who have the disorder.
Fantastic. Okay, that was really great.
Yeah.
That was great. I want to say thank you very much, Mike, for coming on.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you. We would like to thank Mike for being here. And remember, for more on Move to Include and Camp Eager, you can head to our website, homeworkhotline.org. Now stay right there. We'll be back in a minute. I said, hey,
hey. When dividing two fractions, find the reciprocal of the second fraction. Then multiply the fractions together to get your answer.
All right, we have a winner in tonight's brain teaser. Winner, who are you, and tell us about this person we were asking you.
My name's Aislinn Brooks.
Okay.
And you asked us who was the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and yes. He served George Washington.
Right.
Yes. So who was it?
The answer is John Marshall.
Fantastic.
That is great. Now, did you use any of the clues in order to help you find this, or did you just know this from school?
I used some of the clues you gave us.
Okay. Now, how did you use them? What did you do with them?
I didn't exactly know the correct answer, but I used the clue, who was the fourth Chief Justice of Supreme Court.
Nice.
And so I searched online for some answers, and it took me a while, but I finally figured it out, and it was John Marshall.
Very good.
That is a great job.
All right. So, now, congratulations. Don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
And tune in tomorrow for our Hotline Book Reviews.
Good night. Good night.
Tonight's Homework Hotline was presented as part of Move to Include, made possible with support from the Golisano Foundation. Learn how you can be more inclusive of people with disabilities. Log on to homeworkhotline.org. Click the Move to Include button.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.